Hello, Zero K fans! This is Shadow Fury CC3 bringing you another exhibition match stream. Starting off today, we're going to have a match between Lauri and ElTorero on Barren. Nothing more to say, let's get started. ElTorero starting with the Shield Bot Lab in the southeast corner of the map. And sporting a nice. Is that a faction logo? No, it's a clan logo. International Sandwich Protectors. I believe that's the name of the clan. And Lauri, also apparently in that clan, but not the same logo. Actually, I gotta double check that clan logo, but it looked like it was likely ISP. Anyway, Lauri, Northwest, going for Shieldbot Factory as well. Lauri going for 5 quick bandits. Wow, okay, sorry. Bandit, convict, and then 4 bandits. So he's going for a bit. Actually, same as ElTorero, actually. Both players going for a bit more of a scout into economy setup rather than a very strict rating or strict economy setup. So Lauri, however, is going much more quickly into offense. ElTorero not producing. He is focusing much more on very rapid economy. And he is getting an economic advantage as a result. We'll see if Lauri is able to raid that out to make a difference. But at this point, ElTorero is slightly ahead. He does have an extra metal extractor on Lauri. Same time, he does have. Yeah, there we go. It's done. It's getting few more power plants as well, so ElTorero is getting ahead economically, but at the cost of units. Well, Lauri is not stopping production at all, and as a result is splitting resources between the two. However, Lauri's commander is at high priority, so it's not the biggest deal in the world. That being said, ElTorero does have to be a bit careful about his defense here. He does have a defender up, as does Lauri, though Lauri managed to get rid of ElTorero's bandit without any issue whatsoever. While ElTorero, on the other hand, did he even deal with Lauri's bandit? I don't see that. Oh, I feel silly. Yeah, Lauri has, well, set up his base pretty well, as has ElTorero. So both players are pretty even at this point. Neither player too far ahead. Lauri not really able to raid out ElTorero, but ElTorero not actually able to expand quickly enough to take full advantage of the fact that he had an early economic advantage. In fact, Lauri is starting to get ahead on that, having started to expand to the north, or across the north to the east. Bit ahead of ElTorero's expansion across the south. So ElTorero is still about even. Lauri and ElTorero, surprisingly enough, neither of them are actually dealing that much damage to each other. ElTorero is posturing a bit more forward, but neither of them feel confident they can go through this valley in the center, and that is not surprising. Barren is not the sort of map that encourages a great deal of aggression. It's very easy to get that high ground advantage for the defender. Kind of difficult to get in and attack. Especially when you're dealing with high-skill players like this, they know that it's a problem, and neither of them is too keen on getting in. However, ElTorero is, in fact, going in. He is going for it. Bit of a risk, but it might work out. He does actually have one of his bandits distracting 4 of Lauri's, but the other one runs straight into the commander, so Lauri not too concerned about this. However, ElTorero does have a good angle. If he goes across here with his bandit, he would actually be able to deal a... Well, okay. The defender gets in the way. He'd have to be really careful about that. But still, I think he'd... Yeah, there's a very narrow path, but that, I don't think he'd be able to pull that off without losing the bandit. It just, he doesn't know where that defender is. It's not even a matter of skill. It's a matter of lack of knowledge. There's no way he could know that. However, that being said, ElTorero does actually have very little knowledge of what's going on inside Lowry's base. He knows a bit from an initial scout, and that also goes for Lauri. Lauri knows a little bit about ElTorero's base, the inside of it, but overall, neither player too knowledgeable about the other's frontline. ElTorero is more knowledgeable, however, as a result of having explored with that bandit, and ultimately not losing either bandit from the looks of it. He seems to have managed to survive that and get the information he needs. That being said, Lauri has a roach set up just to be sure. Just in case ElTorero does attack in force, there is a roach set up to deal with that, and ElTorero is still building more bandits while Lauri is switching over to convicts. In fact, Lauri appears to be going convict felon ball, so wants to finish this up pretty quickly, getting a felon ball right away, just bypassing the... Well, I guess it's not exactly bypassing the riot stage. Felon is pretty much the riot for the shield bots, in effect, since the outlaw nerfed some time ago. And ElTorero was setting up a few more defenses. A couple lotus, well, lotus and another lotus over the north side of his base. While Lauri, on the other hand, at the south side, setting up a defender and... This game is looking to become a rather bogged down match. So if it does, I will speed it up. I fully reserve the right to speed the replay up using this handy dandy little control over here in the corner, because I think that is going to become necessary. And ElTorero getting a scout in, losing a bandit, unfortunately not able to take out the roach in the process, which would have been a very useful way to lose the bandit. but losing it to a defender instead, which not quite so cost effective. Having the roach kill itself on a single bandit would have been a waste of a roach, and would have also, I think it did reveal the roach's existence, so ElTorero is going to be more wary about that, and I'm going to speed the replay up a bit, just because I'm starting to get a bit worried that not much is going to happen in a little while, and ElTorero and Lauri just posturing, both of them well aware of what the other has going. Yeah, ElTorero has the entire map, and Lauri has pretty much the entire map as well that they know about. So neither player has much freedom in their movement. Both players are well aware when the other is moving and sends the units to respond. Looks like ElTorero is pushing his commander up in a bit of a risky position. We'll see, though. Felons are starting to be set up for Lauri, and ElTorero continuing to posture along the southwest side of the map. And Lauri, saying it too often, Lauri losing a bandit to the defenders. But we have the front line, that's the thing. A thug trying to come in here for ElTorero, as well as some rogues. That's actually going to be kind of useful, actually. If those rogues get in, however, one of them does go down, but a couple of the defenders are down as well, with thugs coming in for backup. Why the thugs aren't coming in to tank the shots from the defenders, I don't... Actually, they sort of are. The shields are tanking the shots. Nicely done there, ElTorero. Keeping the shields in front of the rogues. That is what he needs to do. At the same time, Lauri is setting up a defensive line at the northeast side of the map, but ElTorero's commander in place, he can tank that shot and go in from there. But Felon's behind that will be a problem. In fact, Felon and a couple thugs as well. Lauri, on the other hand, losing his southwest. He lost the metal extractor. He's losing a lot of his defenders as well. But even with that, another rogue goes down. The rogue's not getting into the thugs as ElTorero a bit too focused on the northeast side of the map. Will lose a bunch of bandits to this Felon. This Felon here, this is a riot unit, pretty much. At least as far as cost effectiveness goes for the shields. It can't really kill large things effectively due to the fact that it does lose the shields too quickly. But against a large army of small things, it will get a lot of kills in before it runs out of shields. As we are seeing, with all the bandits going down, all the bandits are going down. ElTorero might be able to save this one over here. This is about... Nope, these two. Two bandits survive out of about a dozen, and Lauri comes in to take the northeast side of the map. And still holds on to the southwest, so ElTorero is falling behind ever so slightly. Getting a bit of reclaim from his own units, but unfortunately for him, not really able to take the southwest as he had hoped, while Lauri able to take the northeast. So Lauri getting a bit ahead while ElTorero up on the high ground, and this is where the game could very well bog down. The center here is quite open, so either player could go through it, but I don't think either of them is aware of that particular openness. And Lauri coming with the Felon, unfortunately he's going to run out of shields right at this Lotus, and that will work out poorly. Gets rid of the defender though, but not the Lotus, meaning his Felon has to move back, and the Felon actually is, surprisingly enough, not taking very much damage. Has enough shields to avoid that too much, but it is still taking some damage. Mostly just the sheer amount of health it has is stopping it from taking any meaningful damage. Let me go back to 2x speed again, just before something happens. But it looks like ElTorero is risking it in the center of the map. He's gonna go in, he's gonna hit that roach. He is, however, staying in the middle of the valley, and Lauri can take advantage of this, moving a Felon up, knowing what could be useful here, and the roach about to go off. Will go off. Yes, goes off, gets rid of all the bandits. That's 8 bandits out. That is cost effective for Lauri. Nicely done, Lauri. Like I said, a bit of a risk that ElTorero did there. Admittedly, that is the only undefended part of the map, or was. Now ElTorero was setting up a Lotus, but that was the only undefended part of the map. It was a good call for ElTorero to go in that general direction, but he did not check for the landmine. He didn't say send a bandit ahead to check for a roach. Surprisingly, he must have forgotten that he had seen the roach earlier on, because he did see that roach earlier on. But yeah, that's what you do when you're dealing with that sort of thing. If you're thinking your opponent has roaches, you just make sure units aren't clumped up. I like send them in a line so that they aren't clumped up, or if you... Actually, it's hard to demonstrate with two. But yeah, it's hard to demonstrate when you're not playing. Or send one ahead of the rest of the group. Or send a couple ahead in different directions just to see if there are roaches there, because the roaches will just go off, or will likely go off and the other player's not paying attention. However, Lauri taking some damage to the southwest side of the map, and it looks like ElTorero trying to deal with this, but I don't see this working out. The thugs are doing a decent job tanking, but now the rogues are taking all the damage. The thugs aren't even really doing much, having no shields charged left, dealing with what they can, but unfortunately that'll only be a couple defenders. The stinger probably won't even go down before the thugs do. Nope. Certainly will not go down before the thugs do. The sheer mass of defenders gets rid of it, and the stinger finishes it off. While at the same time, on the northeast side of the map, Lauri pushing him with the felons and bandits, or felons, thugs, trying to deal with ElTorero's commander and just ElTorero's defenses. However, ElTorero's commander will be able to get away. His defenses, obviously not so much. They cannot move by definition. They are static defenses. However, they will actually still get away with this. They'll still have enough firepower to push off Lauri's attack, and one of the lotuses does die. But the other two lotuses are perfectly fine, and ElTorero going into a morph. Given that he has this economic disadvantage right now, he's behind mostly on account of reclaim, but he's still behind economically. And definitely in terms of map control, we see that ElTorero right now has this triangle of the map, while Lauri has pretty much the entire center. The middle valley is totally no man's land, though this middle extractor could belong to Lauri. But otherwise, Lauri does have about 5 metal extractors on ElTorero. ElTorero, however, reclaiming just now, trying to get around this. And just point out that ElTorero's main base also does have, like, there's a couple 1 metal expansions here. The rest of the expansions in the middle of the map are pretty much all 2 metal expansions. There's a couple 1 metal expansions, 1.5 metal expansions. The very center, no man's land area, is all 2 metal. And the corners also about 3.5 metal total for each corner. But still, Lauri overall does have a healthier economy. And ElTorero going through the center, the undefended center again. No roach replacement for the one that went off. Giving these bandits free reign to go through and attack from the northwest. A couple of them will go down to defenders, but the rest will take care of everything without issue. All these bandits are going to be able to just tear apart the entire base here. Unfortunately, getting distracted by the solar collectors, that is not what they need to do. What they need to do is to get through to this metal extractor, get the radar, get the defender here. He can't take care of the lower expansion, but he can take care of pretty much everything else. And unfortunately, the defender has had a chance to reload and will be able to get rid of the bandit. So the entire bandit party has to go back, which is unfortunate. He managed to take care of a couple metal extractors, but not meaningfully make a dent in Lowry's lines. Lauri, on the other hand, what lions he has! 3 Aspices moving in with a felon and a small contingent of thugs. A couple outlaws as well for slowing down. But yeah, 2 felons, 3 Aspices. That is going to be a lot of firepower for the felons. Assuming they all get in together. One of the felons is a bit off. But once they get together, then that will be... how much? Let's just look up. Aspis has 3,600 shield strength, while felon has 1,200. So in terms of overall... well, who cares? Never mind. I was going to say, in terms of overall damage, it's going to be about 3 times a felon for each Aspis, but it doesn't matter because one of the felons, one of the Aspices, does go down to a nicely placed roach. It's in the center map for a little while. And Racketeers is trying to take care of the rest of the outlaws. Shields are getting in the way, and Disarm not doing too much. However, that roach does force Lauri back, and I think that might be the theme of the match so far. That being said, neither player really building a whole lot more roaches. Nope, ElTorero not doing so, and Lauri going for felons and switching over to airplane plant, getting a couple ravens. What is he going to do with these ravens? We'll have to wait to find out. He is not doing anything with them yet. However, he is going for another attack, and this one I think will actually be successful. And what the... okay, that was weird. Didn't intend to go down 2 times speed. Anyway, this one will be successful, and... or at least will push back ElTorero and get back for his earlier attack. Another roach, however, does take out an outlaw and a thug, but ultimately that wasn't the big damage dealer. Useful support unit, but not the biggest story. And at the same time, ElTorero going to the southwest side of the map with 7 thugs. Getting in, probably going to get rid of most of these defenders, probably not going to get rid of the Stinger, although with the... actually, no, with the Racketeer, the Stinger will go down. And getting rid of Caretakers as well, this whole entire reclaim party is starting to go down. The thugs taking some damage from all the lotuses, but they are managing to take them out as well. And Lauri going to the northeast with his units, tearing apart everything that was set up in the northeast. But even with that, all these rogues are actually getting rid of the shields effectively, stopping the felon from attacking, and these outlaws nowhere near enough to those rogues to actually deal any damage, or slow them down, rather. Shieldblood Factory full of support units. The only real main combat units... Lauri's commander goes down, by the way, to the thugs. The only real main combat units are the bandits, the thugs, and the felons. Racketeers and outlaws are great support units. Roaches are, of course, great landmines, but rather difficult to push into battle directly. And other than that, there's really not much. Yeah, there's the vandals for anti-air, but that's about it. Oh, yeah, and the rogues. Okay, the rogues are also direct fire. But still, not a whole lot of direct fire. The riot is pretty much the felon at this point. However, like I said, southwest ElTorero is taking that out, and he didn't successfully deflect the attack from the felons, but he could still rebuild pretty well. His commander is very much alive, unlike Lauri's. And he has, I think, more workers, too. Better to say, though, it looks like... No, Lauri, all of his workers are focused in his main base and over to the northeast. While ElTorero, on the other hand, his workers... Actually, he has fewer workers. They're a bit more spread out, though, reclaiming around the map, which is keeping ElTorero in the game somewhat. And actually, ElTorero pushing back quite effectively into Lauri's... Okay, so Lauri's southwest is down. Lauri's middle west side is going down pretty quickly as well. Raven's doing what they can, but against five thugs like this, they're not going to be damaging them that quickly. The big problem for them, though, is the sheer number of shields coming in with the felons. So ElTorero does have to retreat. Can't stay on this. Some vandals as well, just in case, to get rid of the raven. It's not a bad idea. However, they won't be able to do it in time. Won't be able to kill this raven. The combination of defenders and vandals will, however, but another thug gets heavily damaged. I don't believe it went down, but it does get heavily damaged. Still, ElTorero forced retreat, but able to reclaim the southwest side of the map. So Lauri, his economic advantage has been mitigated, and he is going to be getting forced back to his base once again, which, as we saw before, is a really safe, possibly overly safe position. Yeah, very safe for him, and he is moving in. Racketeers, however, stopping his felons and his thugs, forcing him to retreat, and neither player able to get a whole lot of damage in. I'm a little bit surprised that Lauri hasn't gone for any phoenixes, though. Only a little bit. I'm not terribly surprised that he's not, but... They aren't the most popular units. I'm just a little bit surprised he hasn't gone for two or three of them just to torch out this entire line. Or gone for Thunderbirds, actually. The unit formerly known as the Stiletto. He is, however, going for a Cloakybot factor, which is explaining his lack of unit production. ElTorero, however, staying fully... Another Roach coming in to deal with a couple felons, but yeah, ElTorero staying fully with the Shieldbot factory, not bothering to switch out, not deciding to change factories. And Lauri forced to retreat, awaiting Cloakybot factory, which he'll probably use for snipers, I would think. Maybe for ticks. He might go really crazy and go for an eraser roach combo just to push those roaches in. Get them in, tear apart these groups of units without giving them any opportunity to fight back in advance. But it looks like no, he's going for 500 glaives. Not nearly as dramatic as I had hoped, but that's not terribly surprising. They are a popular unit. Still, I kind of expected to go for additional units to deal with the large clumps of shielded units that Lauri has set up, and the fact that Lauri has. Quite an anti-air line right now. It's Chainsaw, he has a decent number of vandals, half a dozen in the northeast. Chainsaw is in place, that has... What is the attack range of a chainsaw anyway? Oh wow, yeah, so ElTorero's entire airspace is covered by that chainsaw. There's no easy way Lauri is going to get in. At least not by air, but by 500 glaives, he might have a chance. I would say the first 100 or 200 or so, that would probably do the trick. 500 is a little excessive. Yeah. Typical 0k knowledge. No more than 200 or 300 glaives. Anything more than that is just too much. Lauri, however, is trying to retake the southwest. Sorry. Not trying. He is retaking the southwest. ElTorero had used it for reclaim fodder, which definitely does slow down Lowry's expansion or re-expansion attempts, but didn't actually try to take it for himself. ElTorero did not go for it whatsoever. Just reclaimed the entire thing and left. Bit of an odd way of going about it. While Lauri does have a solid hold on the northeast, ElTorero did not try to take the southwest. Rather bizarrely. And here come the glaives. Far fewer than 500. In fact, only about half a dozen coming in to deal with some of the defenses here. Actually, no, the defenses were already down. They've been down for a while. But deal with some of the units that have been set up already. I really don't agree with the glaives. Just because he already has bandits. I would think he'd have gone for, like I said, sharpshooters or eraser... Either tick or eraser roach combo. Or... No, I don't think warriors wouldn't really work. Against the number of... Okay, warriors are a bad idea. Scythe could actually work okay. It'd be a little bit tricky. But if you manage to get through... Maybe we'll just scythe... Actually, scything in the front lines and then tearing everything else apart from that might work. But it looks like he's planning on doing that with glaives instead. Using the glaives just to deal with everything in the front lines. Tearing them apart. And then from there, probably going to just... His mass shield ball. Once he has the glaives tearing out the defense, he's probably going to use the shield ball to just tear apart everything else. The glaives, however, are being stopped by the bandits and additional roaches that ElTorero had already set up. More convicts are... Actually, racketeers are going down. A good target to pick. However, unfortunately, those glaives do get disarmed, go down. One of the racketeers does die, but more racketeers are on the way. One currently in production, and ElTorero, with all the reclaim he has, can produce pretty effectively. At this point, Lauri does not have the economic advantage. Actually, Yeah, period. Or at least, it's hard to say. It looks like between Reclaim, ElTorero is able to keep the advantage to himself. Without Reclaim, Lauri has a slight advantage, but not enough to be able to just throw units away like that as willy-nilly as he has been. At least with the Glaives, it's not so bad. The Glaives are pretty cheap units. It's not a big deal with the Glaives. But these Felons, on the other hand, it is a big deal. One of them does go down, another one about to go down, and getting disarmed with a Rogue... No, Rogue Rocket not quite hitting it, but a Defender Rocket, or Defender Missile does. And ElTorero, with confidence taken from destroying that Felon, he's moving in with the Rogues in full force, too. Wow, those Rogues are just tearing apart everything that Lauri has. While Bandits coming to the center, a couple Roaches, however, or three Roaches, however, are going to destroy most of the Bandits, but the other half of the army get away from the Chain Explosion and still able to come through. That being said, Major Equalizer keeping Lauri's forces from having to be too large to deal with that incoming attack. At the same time, ElTorero coming in with half a dozen thugs along the northeast side of the map, trying to deal with Lauri's base buildup. I don't think he's going to be able to do much quickly. A lot of these thugs are probably too far back to, they're too far back to deal any damage. Need to move a bit forward, need to be more of an even line. Southwest side, ElTorero has not managed to move the line forward at all, and in the center, ElTorero has had to retreat, Lauri managing to push him back. The Roaches did a pretty good job, but unfortunately the Bandit's not really able to follow up. Lauri coming in with further forces along the southwest side of the map, and the northeast side of the map, ElTorero has set himself up properly with the thugs and is able to take out pretty much everything. Back to the southwest side of the map, Lauri coming in with more Glaives to deal with the Rogues. Not a bad idea, but unfortunately with the sheer amount of wreckage, the Glaives can't actually do all that much. They can't dodge the shots especially well. Although they can apparently dodge them well enough, it's just rather difficult being... The terrain has been so deformed with so much wreckage along it that the Glaives are having a very hard time maneuvering. And now the Rogues have gone into a nice line, the Glaives will go down. However, the northeast side of the map, thugs have gone down as well. Enough Lotus is being built up that all the thugs have gone down. Completely missed that, but... Well, there was a battle going on simultaneously in the southwest, so that's my excuse. ElTorero has himself set up to deal with basically round two. To push in, he could probably push in with the Rogues right now, actually. And on the northeast side of the map, Lauri has static defenses, but not much else. And ElTorero is ahead by about 1,500 metal for his army. Lauri switching over to nukes. Okay, Lauri is... There we go, there he's getting sharpshooters. But see, Lauri's getting kind of indecisive. He's going for Napalm Missile now. On top of having built, well, Shield Blood Factory, switching to Air Factory, switching to Cloaky Blood Factory, and then Missile Silo. Lauri seems a little bit unsure what to do to get ahead at this stage. I think the Napalm Missile is a good idea, though. I'm a little bit uncertain where that actually can hit, but... No, seriously, where can it actually hit? It's supposed to be range in this thing. Oh, there it is. Yeah, I can hit the majority of the map, actually. Most of the map can be hit by this attack. This area down here is the best option, and where did it fire at it? Wait. Oh, I can't easily tell. Fires at a completely open section of the map. That is unfortunate for ElTorero. He gets rid of one radar tower. Sorry, Lauri. He gets rid of one radar tower, not the other. And at the same time, Southwest comes in. Southwest flank comes in, and ElTorero starts to deal with more and more of Lowry's forces. I am rather surprised Lauri didn't go to the southwest. This seems like the ideal place to fire off an Inferno. But he has another one, and we will see where that one is directed to in just a moment when he gets shot off. Bound to happen any minute now. And Sharpshooter, very nearly done as well. Lauri has it completed. First Sharpshooter out of the gate. No real Felons though, nothing to really sharpshoot. A lot of Rogues, like a good couple dozen Rogues, but... And a couple dozen Bandits as well. But no real single big targets. If there was Felons up against, I could sort of see this, but... Really, the Warriors that are coming in later makes sense. The use of the Inferno makes sense. Though the lack of the Inferno usage does not make sense. I think Lauri is distracted by the... What is Lauri looking at right now? Lauri right now looking at the base, and he is actually firing off the Inferno. There we go. He decided to shoot that off, and that is unfortunately a little bit late. Gonna be able to get rid of one Lotus, but not going for the major assault in the southwest. I'm a little bit surprised he didn't go for that. Like, Lauri right now does... Actually, what does Lauri see? Lauri does see the attack with the Rogues. He does not actually see all those Bandits there, so... Okay, benefit of the doubt, he does not know they're there. He does, however, know that the Rogues are here somewhere. And now he has a lot of radar coverage, seeing a bunch of dots coming in, so he's going to have a decent idea that there's something to hit over near the southwest. However, okay, there we go, getting another Inferno up. His convicts are not by the missile silo, however. They are, in fact, over to the northeast. Looks like he's trying to... Is he... He is building a Stinger line over into ElTorero's base while ElTorero attacks with rogues over to the southeast. With rogues and racketeers, the Stingers can't do anything. Matter of time, but ElTorero does have it at this point. At least the southwest. He has secured it pretty well. Still a bit contentious, but honestly, there are so many units here that just shut down everything that Lauri is throwing at them. Lauri is not reinforcing his shields, or very little reinforcements. Just trying to get reinforcements for shields, and not focusing on the Inferno whatsoever. In fact, Lauri is splitting his metal pretty heavily between the Cloaky Shield and Nuke Silo. None of them building units very quickly, and ElTorero at this point has double the income. I mean, I noticed the spectator earlier on when that roach went off here, the first roach against the bandits, they said that the game was over, but I think ElTorero has managed to turn that around. And honestly, ElTorero is in a very strong position right now. He is easily winning. And once again, pushing forward, he is going to be able to get through this defense line, no problem. No roaches in the way, for that matter. There's nothing. ElTorero is going to be able to push through this, and Lauri has got little to answer, but he does... Nope, he's not even getting the Inferno anytime soon. He's getting the Stinger line, actually Stardust into defenders, just massive defense line. But nothing really beyond that. And Lauri is, with these sharpshooters, going to be able to deal a bit of damage, but once they get... If they get hit at all, if they get discovered, if they get decloaked, they're about to get decloaked. This one, oh, very close to getting decloaked as the shots hit all these convicts. Trying to shield support each other, but even with that, they are taking... Well, the shield is taking a lot of damage, and they themselves are going to start taking a great deal of damage fairly soon as well. Enough rogues just firing missiles off into these convicts with total impunity, tearing them apart without issue. Racketeers stunning out a bunch of them, getting rid of their shields. Convicts have to retreat, and the rogues not daring to go up the... No, they are daring to go up the hill. What am I saying? They are, in fact, going up the hill. At the same time, Scythe's coming in from ElTorero. I missed that. He has apparently gone for Cloakybot as well. Or, no, he has not. I think he might have gone for... That must be... Is that a morph? That can't be... That could be a morph. Maybe. I guess? I'm not 100% sure with the morph. However, a roach coming in, getting rid of these rogues. Perfect roach placement, by the way. That was... Totally missed that. Perfect roach there, and at the same time, bandits are moving in, and... If someone could tell me if rogues can turn... Rogues not morphing the size. Not sure where he got the size then. However, it doesn't matter where he got the size. The point is he has them and is moving in. Strongly getting rid of Lowry's wind generators. Lotus is getting in the way, but caretaker is going down. Factories will likely soon go down. The Lotuses are the only real problem. And unfortunately, they are becoming a massive problem here. Size, however, not going to be able to get rid of this factory. The warrior going to get rid of it too soon. Or will it? No, the warrior is actually having a bit of trouble getting to that scythe. The scythe gets rid of the Steelbot factory. That's going to be a decent blow. Yeah, where is the Cloakybot factory? Or Athena? Or there it is. There, I was looking for that. There is the Athena. That's how we got the scythes in. A little surprised he didn't proxy that, but one more shot. There we go. Gets rid of the Steelbot factory. So Lowry has no more shield reinforcements here for the southwest side of the map. He has Cloakybot reinforcements, and his Inferno is done. Another roach coming in, that could actually be quite effective, though really getting rid of that rogue army was huge. ElTorero losing that rogue army just completely stopped that attack in its tracks. It probably would have won in the game too, but roaches are turnaround units, that's what they do. They just, roaches and ticks, they bring you out of tight spots. You have to be careful in how you use them, but if you use them well, they can turn the match right around. And bandits coming in with Felon opposition is not going to work out too well for the bandits. More rogues, however, are upcoming. Rogues and thugs and outlaws as well are coming in from ElTorero, and he has actually, he's got to rebuild some of his metal. He's got 17 metal income just raw, and Lowry's taking the northeast side slowly but surely with static defense. ElTorero is able to start taking out the northwest, or sorry, southwest, not the northwest. If you take out the northwest, that would be basically winning the game. No further size seems more coming. In fact, this Athena doesn't seem to be doing anything at all. A little surprise, just sort of hanging out here. It was doing well with the size, but wait, what is it? Okay, it has units queued up. Some bandits and conjurer, apparently. More size wouldn't be a bad idea, but nope, not going for that. He is, in fact, just hitting this, actually nicely flanking this line. One of the felons trying to move out, but it's been disarmed, and the rogue's able to just deal with this. And a silo? No, the silo's still not being used. This Inferno over the back here It's been there for about 5 minutes now. Has yet to be used, would be very effective against these rogues. A roach, however, does work nicely against half of the rogues, but not against all of them. The best thing the roaches probably have done has been to just tear apart this land, making it harder to path around. Not impossible, mind you, but actually it has cut off more and more of the map, making it harder for bots to get around, making it just slower for them to get up, making the uphill struggle that much more uphill, or rather that much more of a struggle, to be more precise. Really, it's both, because, of course, the units have a max angle that they can go up. Fourth, in this particular case, the bandits would have had to split, which actually would have probably been a good thing, because only half of them would have died to that warrior over there. Still, northeast side of the map, we have Lauri losing his, or at least getting his defense line heavily attacked. The thugs having to clump up to try to avoid getting killed, but unfortunately, it doesn't much matter at this point. No, this defense line is staying up. Slightly damaged, but not anywhere near enough for ElTorero to really breach it. Gotta say, ElTorero losing these rogues, probably the turning point of the game at this point. That is the thing that's left Lauri in a position where he's actually able to come back. Was that rogue, sorry, that roach right there, getting rid of all those rogues. Does not appear that there are any further roaches in the, oh, obviously, the Shieldbot factory is just being rebuilt right now. But in either case, an Inferno being set up in the wrong spot, I'm afraid. Lauri has not been firing off well with the Infernos. Now, double checking, he does know pretty well where ElTorero's army is at this point. So it looks like that was either it's a dodge or poor timing, but yeah. Lauri unfortunately didn't miss that attack. He does have another Inferno up. Not using it quite yet, but he can if he wishes. Okay, well, it'll be a slow time again, so we'll once again have to go back to double time. However, Lauri actually going, trying to take the center valley, not able to do too much, has to be pushed back. And is another Inferno forthcoming? No, and that Inferno is not being used either. Lauri is presently not using the Inferno to take out all these racketeers. He very well could, but he has chosen against, or he's not chosen to do anything. He's currently focused more on the southwest side of the map, trying to just force away ElTorero, and we are back into World War I mode. Nothing going on, both, actually not really World War I, it's not really trenches so much as it's hills. However, it looks like Lauri is going to go for a strong attack. These Roccos, I don't think they'll have much of a chance, but they're going to try, darn it. The Racketeers are losing a lot of shots here, and the Roach finishing them off, getting rid of all of them. Well, half of them at least, the ones that really moved forward. The rest of them able to retreat. The Racketeers not really allowing anything more, but an Inferno once again coming in and not quite hitting. It's close, but not quite, unfortunately. I think Lauri, no, he was going off the edge of his radar, so didn't quite fire in the right spot. If he fired it right here, this exact position would be devastating for ElTorero. But we'll see what happens in about 10 seconds. Lauri about to get another missile, and he will likely know where to fire it now. He's fired off enough misses, he's got to get a hit sooner or later. Point out that Strider coming in, Dante coming in for Lauri, sorry, for ElTorero. Not Lauri, what am I saying? ElTorero getting the Dante. That will be a few minutes left. Okay, 7 minutes apparently in the current build time. We'll see though, ElTorero might get some lucky reclaim. He does have no real reclaim to his own, so it's not going to work out for him very well. However, he does have an impaler, thanks to the Athena. So again, that is rather handy. I'm sure Lauri has gotten wise to the fact that Athena has been built. ElTorero has gone for that. We don't see that very often in one-on-one. I think we never see that in one-on-one. So, I mean, that'd be funny if someone actually started with Athena. We never, ever, ever see that in one-on-one. No one ever starts with an Athena. It'd be hilarious if they did, but it never happens. Just pointing that out. If someone does, please let me know. That'd be interesting. I actually have my little thumbnail thing set up just in case someone starts with an Athena. But I don't think that's ever going to be necessary. If it is, however, I am ready. And Stardust has gone down to the Impaler. Actually, to Impalers and Rogues. Thug coming in afterwards just to tear apart everything else. And Aegis has been built up to try to help with defense here. I don't think that's going to matter so much, though. I mean, ElTorero moving into the center. And the center still the least defended area on this part of the map. Actually, least defended area on the map, I should say. There are some units here, but if Lauri loses them, basically if these sharpshooters get revealed, Lauri is going to lose the entire line being held along the center of the map. Although, admittedly, there is a decent amount of overlap in stag defenses. But still, center is a good approach point, and... Oh, never mind. A nice approach point just through the valley, tanking the defender shots and going around the back, going up the hill, and Stinger's only hitting the hill. Not a bad use here, although unfortunately it is going to be a little bit tricky to actually deal any meaningful damage. The Outlaw is doing a decent job. The Thug's going to go down before actually doing much else. The center of the map, however, we do have a bunch of bandits coming in. Not doing much before they retreat, but still at least being a bit of a distraction. Lauri losing very little here, but he is getting a lot of stuff racketeered out. Between the racketeers and the rogues, it's rather difficult to move forward. And it's gonna be, it's just a matter of ElTorero pushing in. I think ElTorero, if he just marched in with everything here, he'd... Well, okay, he's probably thinking he'd lose to a roach, which isn't a bad thing to think. It's inaccurate in this case, but it has proven to be the case the entire rest of the game, so why would he think any different now? I could totally see why he'd do that. And at the same time, Lauri is going to the east side, so I think ElTorero, he's not moving back. No, he's moving back with his bandits. He's not moving back with his rogues. No, what am I saying? He is, in fact, moving back with his rogues. He's proven me wrong at every turn. Anything I say, he's already done the exact opposite. However, his defenses are decently well set up. Sorry, his forces are decently well set up to break through ElTorero's defenses, getting rid of the chainsaw, allowing Arians to be used in ElTorero's airspace once again. However, Lauri has not responded by actually building more units quite yet. The ones he did have, he wasn't using. Actually, they all died, so he just stopped building them. However, rogues coming in, and the bandits will finish them all. Actually, bandits will cut off half of them. The other half might be able to escape. Not likely, though. ElTorero able to at least stop that from dealing any further damage, but two mechs had gone down already. That Dante is 20 seconds away from completion. And with that, I think ElTorero might... No, I would have thought he'd be able to pull us through before with the Dante, but now... I don't know if he has enough units to even push through, even with a Dante. We'll see. But at this point, Lauri has not yet built air units, despite destroying the chainsaw. Not yet going for that. Still is the Inferno, but going to wait for an assault, most likely. Going to wait until ElTorero goes in for a full-on attack, and then just tear it apart with the Inferno. It's very likely to happen. However, I was half right. He missed, however, and that did not do him any good. So once again, Lauri not... Okay, those were out of his radar range, so not terribly surprising he did fire at that. Still, he did miss. ElTorero has been getting kind of lucky this time. None of his units have actually died to napalm missiles, or maybe one or two. But not armies worth. Most of his armies he's lost to roaches. That's where he's been unlucky in this game. Or inattentive, rather. Okay, it's kind of... You can't tell they're close. I mean, you have to push units ahead. It's really tricky to do. But he does have... Still a large enough army. He does have still a larger army, but that's 5,000 metal with the Dante being included in that, mind you. That Dante is part of the 5,000 metal in question. Wherever it is. Ah, here it is. Yeah, it's most of that 5,000 metal difference, actually. And it has been revealed going to the northeast. I can kind of see why he did this, because he wants to break this entire force here. He wants to just tear it apart, take the northeast back, get the economy back. However, he might have wanted to go through the center instead. Now he has to deal with center counterattack from Lauri, while the Dante tears apart the northeast, which Lauri probably didn't care a whole lot about. Well, partially tears apart the northeast. Actually, the Dante's not even going to be able to succeed in doing that. The Stinger's going to finish it off, stopping him from even destroying the northeast, while at the same time the counterattack being pushed back, but still Lauri getting ahead on this. But ElTorero still has 10,000 army value. So I think overall, it is working out for ElTorero more than it is for Lauri. Lauri shifting over to racketeers. Heavy racketeers in his part. His shield factory has been rebuilt, and actually losing more felons to racketeers plus bandits. And the rogues moving in as well, so ElTorero still has a stronger army. The Dante was kinda useful, but unfortunately did not live to his full potential. No further Dantes appear to be coming in at this point. The Athena helping out with some impalers, adding a few more of those in there, but no further striders are being built at this point. They are soon, we'll see. However, Thunderbird coming in here, which could be handy. We'll see if it's actually being used. The Vandals were still in place. The Vandals have not been knocked out of place since the beginning of the game. I don't believe any further Vandals have actually been built. Sorry, there are the Vandals. No, that's bandits. Well, there are still a few Vandals, apparently, because they were doing what they do. Firing missiles into the sky and tearing apart whatever's in there. In this case, the Thunderbird, which is unable to do anything, allowing ElTorero a bit more time. So ElTorero is Well, he's attacking the southwest. Getting attacked in the center, and the northeast is currently completely uneventful. Yeah, bandits and glaives coming, sorry, glaives mostly coming from the center. Getting torn apart by ElTorero's bandits, and that was a nice surround, nice retreat into surround by ElTorero, keeping Lauri from pushing in too far. While ElTorero comes in with, oh, never mind, he retreats. He did have a nice attack in with the thugs, but the Thunderbird tears it apart, or takes it, and stops it. Just prevents it from attacking at all, disarms the entire army of thugs, forces them to go back. Entire raiding party has to go back, but Rose coming in instead, which probably won't last especially long, but still, it's going to be tricky. ElTorero, however, coming in, going to try to take out the northeast. Still, it's still problematic. Going back to the center base, or Lauri's base, not much going in here. Another Inferno coming up, and more Racketeers and more Glaives. On the other hand, no real production other than the Impalers coming in for ElTorero. Though ElTorero does have a couple thousand more metal, it's going to be... Once again, we're in a bit of a slow section of the game. Thunderbird is coming in trying to get rid of the bandits, and will be able to do so, disarming a bunch of the bandits, and it looks like Lauri, is he going to take advantage of the situation? I believe he will, but not with a lot of units, unfortunately. The bandits are going to be disarmed for the next couple seconds. No, they're not even disarmed anymore. Unfortunately, Lauri unable to take advantage of that at all. ElTorero able to just defend as well as if he hadn't been Thunderbird in the first place. But with the Racketeers essentially doing the same thing back to Lauri and preventing him from attacking in any meaningful amount. Lauri, however, does have a very strong defensive line at the southwest and the northeast. The center is getting more and more strongly defended, but I still think there's an easy way to cut through the center. It seems like it's probably the easiest path. But at this point, ElTorero a bit more focused on his defense, and Lauri, I think, slowly breaking in. In fact, with a nice Thunderbird shot, now this is where the follow-up can happen. A nice Thunderbird shot on the Racketeers would do it. That would basically... Oh, unfortunately, doing ElTorero's job for him. Lauri disarms his own glaives instead of the Racketeers. That was an unfortunate miss. If he managed to get the Racketeers, that would have basically won Lauri the game. He had his units in position, the Racketeers would have gone down. That's been what's keeping ElTorero in here. ElTorero has been just racketeering everything Lauri sends in, stopping him from dealing any damage due to the disarm, and keeping his units alive. And there we go! An Inferno missile hits the mark, and the best mark of them all. The entire army of Racketeers, they are not going to die, however, but still a good mark to hit. And the main army does get stunned out. The Thunderbird does manage to get most of these units disarmed for the next 10 seconds or so. Glaives coming in for follow-up. However, enough static defenses will mean that they won't all go down, but the Glaives still dealing the damage they can, which is actually quite meaningful. Getting rid of a couple convicts as well, and it looks like ElTorero has lost his commander in all the chaos. And Lauri gonna move in for the kill. So I guess Lauri did ultimately win the game. Mostly, though, due to the Roach explosion on those rogues in the southwest. Nice Roach use against the Glaives right there for ElTorero, but even then, I think Lauri has... He's at least nullified the material advantage, and he has the economic advantage now, having destroyed most of ElTorero's economy. Giving ElTorero a lot of reclaim, but not a lot of other economy to work with. And ElTorero trying to go for a counterattack, getting Thunderbirded with the thugs, but not really worrying about it, just going to tank everything, getting his thugs back in position, and now going to tear apart Lauri's economy as best as he can. These Lotus is still being a thorn in his side, but... Doesn't matter though, a second Thunderbird attack actually doesn't do much. This glaive is these two glaives are the only things that can actually do much against the assault. The Lotuses were stunned just as much as the thugs were. So the glaives force the thugs back, but not the Lotuses. Bit annoying, but yeah, ElTorero tried his best to get to the side here. Got rid of a few wind generators, but not enough. And I think that Lauri, yeah, he's got map control. He's got the north side of the map now. He's pretty well, I mean, the southwest is kind of no one's at this point, but it can kind of be taken pretty easily. And Lauri, pretty much one solid attack pushing in will do the trick. With a Thunderbird to disarm the entire army, the Inferno Missile has extra support though, admittedly. Yet again, miss, but still, they are intimidating, if nothing else. Or at least they're something that could be intimidating. In the middle of a fight, that'll be more useful, I think. However, the Thunderbird is the important thing that has been useful in the middle of fights. And is about to come in once again. There it goes. Another Thunderbird assault. Taking out half of the rogues. And the glaives come in to tear apart the remainder. Any further follow-up? Not quite, but the glaives that are there actually aren't doing enough. The bandits that were already in place managed to stop them, and the rogues that were disarmed getting away, getting undisarmed, and able to start firing again. However, glaives still counter rogues. I mean, glaives counter rogues directly regardless. Raiders in general counter skirmishers, and this is one example of that, where Lauri is going to win the game as a result. Yeah, this is going to be pretty much it. Lauri moving in, another roach for ElTorero, but not enough. No Inferno Muscles coming in yet. Felon coming in for Lauri as backup. But really, the Glaives are just doing the trick. I suppose I shouldn't have questioned Glaives earlier, but now, okay. Earlier, it didn't make so much sense. Now, it definitely does. With all the rogues that ElTorero had built, it makes a lot of sense. Another Impaler goes down, and Thugs coming in. Oh, not quite goes down at, like, 3 health. The Impaler very barely stays alive as ElTorero came in with a bunch of Thugs to stop the attack. Really, all assuming is stemming the bleeding at this point. A lot of conjurers up for Lauri. Not sure why he's going for so many conjurers. That's a little bit bizarre. Yeah. Okay. 6 glaives to 4 conjurers. Is he planning on going for a reclaim party or what? Definitely going for some static defense here. I mean, we noticed he's gone for static defense construction parties earlier in the game, so it's not terribly surprising he'd continue to go for that. However, the Thunderbird gonna come in here, tearing apart these thugs. Not really the strongest force to deal with, but at the same time, with this many. Well, if he had more glaives, if half of these conjurers were glaives, I think Lauri would win the fight now. But unfortunately, they are in fact conjurers and not able to build that. They're not able to attack. They're able to build quickly, but not able to attack anything. So Lauri pushing through these glaives as best he can, focusing mostly on building up thugs and felons, but the glaive follow-up is kind of what he needed. That Thunderbird did not come in when follow-up could. Racketeers are being quite useful, but even with that, it doesn't matter. Like I said, the glaives can tear apart the felons, but the thugs just become problematic for the glaives. However, the roach coming in for Lauri, taking care of quite a few of ElTorero's thugs, and ultimately, I think, destroying that part of the army as well. The Athena has been revealed, but no anti-air nearby. It does not matter. Thugs, however, are pretty heavily damaged, and another army of glaives come in and tear them apart. Thunderbird going to come in to stun them out, but there's no further follow-up after the Thunderbird does its job. Well, okay, goes around and does his job. Actually, goes around and gets stunned out. Not able to do his job, disarmed instead. Disarmed and slowed with defenders just finishing it off. And it looks like I might have been wrong about the Vandals, but the defenders are definitely there to do the same trick. And that Thunderbird is going to go down fairly soon. Unfortunately for it, that Thunderbird has gone down. Looks like we are still in a bit of a slow spot. Both players are racketeering each other, trying to get an opening. More roaches kind of get more in the opening, but nothing, no real movement at this point. In fact, ElTorero actually is trying to go to the southwest, but unable to really push in. Even in the center, unable to really push in. No one's been able to really push in very meaningfully at any point in the map for the last couple minutes. Really not, hey, surprisingly no movement. Racketeers coming in, but no follow-up units. I really don't know, okay. Lauri has switched a bit. I'm not sure why he hasn't built as many glaives as he had been before, but no, he is not. For whatever reason, he's decided to build fewer and fewer glaives, and that is becoming problematic. Another Inferno, another miss. Actually, no, partial miss. Did hit somewhat. And a much better Inferno shot. However, it doesn't matter. ElTorero throws in the towel, realizing he's lost map control, and had actually for a while. But as Lauri closes in, ElTorero throws in the towel, and that is the game. Hope you enjoyed that. I will have another one for you guys in just a moment. I realize that was a very long game, which is probably going to be problematic for a YouTube video, but oh well, whatever. 45 minute game, or 50 minute game, even with my speed up. Even with the fact that I was in 2x speed for parts of it, I clearly wasn't in 2x speed for very much of it. I hope that wasn't too long for you guys, but like I said, we'll have another one, which will be shorter. Stay tuned for that.